Welcome. My name is David Hall. I am the president of the University of the Virgin Islands, and I want to welcome all of you to this global outreach program with the focus on STEM. The University of the Virgin Islands is proud to partner with NASA in supporting this effort. It is critical to the Virgin Islands, to this nation, and to the world. I want to first thank NASA for all of the support it has provided down through the years to the University of the Virgin Islands. We would not have a physics program without their support, and we are proud to be one of the few HBCUs in the nation that offer degrees in physics to our students. Second, I want to thank Dr. David Morris, one of our faculty members who has been a pioneer for us in creating the physics program, for taking our observatory, our Edelman Observatory, to an entirely different level, and for all of the work he has done with NASA and forming this partnership. I also want to thank the leaders of our Caribbean Center for Green Technology, Greg Quinnell, Ms. Chans, Christina Chans, for their work around climate change, which is a focus of this outreach effort. But more importantly, I want to thank and welcome all of the students who will be participating in this gathering, especially those from the Virgin Islands, who we are very proud to have them participate, but the individuals from around the world who will be participating in this global outreach effort are welcomed and should be applauded. STEM and the development of more talent in STEM fields is not only critical to the growth of this nation, but critical to the growth of the world. We will not be able to provide the leaders for economic development, for innovation, if we do not have the requisite number of students in STEM fields. But it is not just economic development and innovation, but as the COVID pandemic has demonstrated to us, we need individuals who are knowledgeable in the healthcare arena, knowledgeable about infectious diseases and all of the ramifications that come from healthcare challenges. These are STEM fields, and we believe that it is important to inspire students at an early age to get them aware of the various career paths and to pursue these areas. And so finally, I want to just indicate that we are proud to host this event. The university, we pride ourselves in trying to be a leader in STEM development, and not just STEM development in general, but especially among those students and groups who are often absent from STEM fields. Unless we are able to tap into all of the resources that are available in our nation and in the world, we will not be able to meet the challenges that we face. And this gathering and this university and NASA are deeply committed to that vision. Welcome. I hope the next few days will be enlightening, inspiring, and will leave a mark on each of you. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Mirza Beg, AP student, and I love physics.
Hi, I'm Shalani Talama, A grade student, and I love biology.
Hi, I'm Sanaya King. I'm an A grade student, and I love chemistry.
And we are
the UVI Water Ambassadors and Future Scientists of Annalisa Cancrine Junior High School.
My name is Cecile Penn, and I am a science teacher at the Adelita Cancrine Intermediate and Junior High School. I have been involved with UVI and the Water Ambassadors Program for more than 8 years. On behalf of UVI President Dr. Hall, the College of Science and Math, and UVI Caribbean Green Technology Center, we want to welcome our colleagues at school across the territory, nationally and internationally.
Let me bring you on a short tour of St. Thomas Pineapple Point at St. John Trunk Bay, United States, Virgin Islands.
Notice the clear blue seas and the beautiful beaches that describe Hull, Megan's, and Trunk Bay. Join me as I take you on a virtual tour of the USVI. Megan's Bay. The water is usually very calm with no waves of current. Great for floating along and for swimming. The bay deepens gradually from shore, making it perfect for small children. Snorkeling is possible along the rocky coast. However, Megan's Bay is not known for good snorkeling, but for the water sports boat rents, paddle boats, kayaks, and sunfish. Beaches, floats, and snorkel sets are available at the concession. Trunk Bay. Ensconced within U.S. Virgin Islands National Park is Trunk Bay in St. John, USVI. The bay's location within the Virgin Islands National Park ensures that the archipelago remains free of aggressive, unsympathetic development, making it one of the most pristine of all places in the Caribbean. The area consists of 3/10 of a mile-long beach that surrounds a half-moon-shaped body of water.
The U.S. drought monitors, which are climatologists, meteorologists, and hydrologists all across the nation who work with researchers at UVI. The scientists from NOAA, National Weather Service, USVA, and many others who use these baseline indicators of droughts.
You see, in the USVI, many collect water.
To use in their homes from rooftop collection.
What the researchers who review this data see is the stress of vegetation, erosion, and compare these images to others taken over longer periods to determine what the impacts of drought are in the USVI and the region. This helps USDA and the Farm Service Agency aid farmers in the territory when severe drought impacts the island. Right now, we are facing drought conditions, and it appears based on the research here, the territory is headed into an earlier drought season than in years past.
To our fellow future scientists watching today from all across the globe, we hope you enjoy the presentations presented by students across the USVI and the nation as we learn more from NASA scientists about how we as students can join the ranks of NASA and begin our journey to UVI and other universities and study STEM to make this world a better, safer place for all of us.
And now, on to NASA's presentations. Thank you.
Dr. Stacy Klein Gardner, and I'm an adjunct professor of biomedical engineering at Vanderbilt University in Nashville, Tennessee. I have the pleasure of serving as the co-principal investigator and co-director of the Engineering for Us All project, or E4USA. The E4USA program seeks to demystify and democratize engineering for us all. The overarching goal is to introduce a broad spectrum of students and their teachers to engineering careers through a high school level introductory engineering course. E4USA is so very represented so strongly today in this wonderful gathering of scientists and engineers. Many thanks to our colleagues at the University of the Virgin Islands for this opportunity. We hope that more high schools around the U.S. will visit our website, e4usa.org, to learn more and consider joining us. Now, off to a wonderful session.
Hi. Let me extend a warm welcome to my fellow scientists and engineers that are joining us today. Greetings from Brentwood High School at Brentwood, Tennessee. We're just south of Nashville. Good to see you all here. We're a proud member of E4USA for the last 3 years, so from its inception. Some of our projects that we work on deal with problems at the school, such as missing locks from the bathroom stalls and how we could possibly lock them for ourselves. Other projects that we work on extend outside of the school through our community partners and partnerships with them, such as with the Nashville Zoo. We're looking forward to spending a little bit of time with you today. Thank you.
Good day, fellow scientists and engineers. Greetings from Brentwood High School, located in Brentwood, Tennessee, just south of Nashville. We are a proud original member of the Engineering for Us All program. Greetings. Through E4USA, we have learned the importance of the engineering design process, the effectiveness of a strong team dynamic, and the huge impact that creativity has on the entire world.
Right now, we are working on an engineering problem at our own school. Brentwood High School has a separate STEM building from the main high school, so teachers, students, administrators, and SROs have to walk outside on uncovered sidewalks no matter what the weather is. We are interviewing our stakeholders now to make sure we define our problem well. We're planning to address the overall problem using preventative and reactive measures to protect people's belongings.
Before the end of the year, we look forward to solving problems posed by several community partners. We'll create enrichment toys for animals at the Nashville Zoo, design and repair tools for the safety measures around the Nashville Super Speedway track, and solve a problem for the Vanderbilt University Medical Center's Department of Neurosurgery.
Thank you!
Around the Nashville Super Speedway
track. All Saints Cathedral School in U.S. Virgin Islands. I'm the head teacher of the E4USA platform at our school. Our students have taken an engineering journey from day one to where they are now. In this video, they're going to show you where we've gone, what we've done, and what they experienced. There's many great things in E4USA, and our students are more than excited to move forward into engineering, even into their college level, where they want to go. So thank you for your time. I hope you enjoy our presentation, and for sure, engineering for all.
My name is Ashraf Kim. I'm a student at Austin Cathedral School. I am in 12th grade, and I really enjoy engineering. Now, let me turn it on to my fellow classmates.
Good morning. My name is Hugh Wing. I'm also a student at All Saints Cathedral School, and I'm in the 11th grade. And engineering class is taking up most of us.
Hello, my name is Isaiah Francis. I'm also a student at All Saints Cathedral School. I'm in the 12th grade, and I'm glad I took the class.
Hello. This is a video that we made to reflect on our engineering dreams.
Here we are, day number 3 on our table. Our frame is painted. Morning, how you doing? Alright, we're gonna start by using the drill. Good morning, everybody. We are in engineering. Today, we are starting our robot challenge. Everybody is smoking as they start thinking about how this is going to work. Good morning. Here we are. Engineering class doing creating a rain shelter. They're brainstorming the process. We will have an update later. Awesome class. Everybody's hard at work. Engineering at its best. We will have an update later. Awesome class. Everybody's hard at work.
phase. They are struggling. Savannah is struggling so hard to keep thing up, but she got hype, but can she do it without holding it? That is the question.
What did you learn from before you were saved?
What we learned through the robotic arm challenge is that we needed to complete our objective through set parameters, and through our mistakes and failures, we could better design and make the project more stronger and our prototype stronger.
What are some of the things you learned from your failures throughout the robotic arm? I learned that there is really nothing called failure. With every fail mistake that you make, it helps you improve and better your design to make the final product, to make it even better, stronger, and more efficient in your project. How has your initial opinion of engineering changed throughout the year?
My first impression of engineering was that I thought it was just about wires and hammer and all kind of tools. But when I came to the engineering class, I started learning more about the other type of engineering and how to work in the world.
In one of my years, in my heart veins, I attend All Saints Cathedral School. I'm in the 12th grade. And how can you elaborate and describe the 5 W's?
First, what we want to look at is the 5 W's. What, who, when, why, and how. What is the problem at hand? Who is the problem affected? Where is the problem at? Why would we create or enhance a design to fix the problem? And how? Through our design process.
Is constructing an underwater turbine ethical?
We have to go through our engineering process to see if it's ethical. And how we're going to do that is by studying the marine life and the people around the Virgin Islands to answer that question.
How can we tell you from what we've learned from the robotic arm challenge into real life?
What we learned from
the robotic arm challenge is there's different types of engineering, such as textile, mechanical, and structural engineering, which ties into our next project, the underwater turbine.
Could you elaborate on why did you choose to do an underwater turbine for your next project?
That's a good question, and that leads into our 5 W's. For the what, is because we need clean energy in the Virgin Islands. For the what, St. Thomas and St. John. For the where, is underwater between St. Thomas and St. John. For the why, is because of the constant flow of directional current between St. Thomas and St. John. And how, that's the question.
What type of engineering do we have to look at when constructing and designing the prototype for an underwater turbine? Could you elaborate?
The different type of engineering we would use is one, textile. We would test and try different types of sealant to see which one is more effective underwater than the underwater turbine. Another type of engineering we would use is mechanical engineering for the mechanical parts that is in the turbine. Another type of engineering we will also use is electrical engineering for all the wires that's in the turbine, and also the wires that are connected to the St. Thomas and St. John, which is feeding the energy. And another type of engineering we will also use is structural engineering for the frame and the stand of the underwater turbine to help it lock underwater. And another type of engineering you would use is cooling, which will help us see from outside and above water what's going on to see if the underwater turbines need repair or something went wrong in outside and above water. What's going on to see if the underwater turbines need repair or something went wrong in outside.
Hello, I'm NASA astronaut Joe Acaba, coming to you from the Johnson Space Center in Houston, Texas. I want to thank Dr. David Hall and the University of the Virgin Islands faculty, staff, and students for inviting me to share a few words and for working with my NASA colleagues to plan and organize this week-long event. All of this in the midst of a global pandemic. These challenging times have been difficult, so it's important for all of us to remain optimistic and resilient. Despite all, here at NASA, we continue to advance research and technology to return to the moon. We are still pushing forward with plans to send the first woman and first person of color to the moon under NASA's Artemis program. No human has set foot on the moon since Apollo 17 in 1972. So the possibility of landing on the moon is incredible. As a young kid of Puerto Rican descent, I was born and raised in Southern California. I've always enjoyed math and science, but my interest in becoming an astronaut started with my grandfather. He had old films of the Apollo missions, which we enjoyed watching together. I've been fortunate to have so many mentors who supported me and motivated me to be where I am today. Prior to joining NASA, I served as a member of the United States Marine Corps Reserves. I also spent 2 years as a volunteer in the United States Peace Corps. I worked a lot of different jobs until I found the one that I thought and still believe is the most important job on the planet, and that was being a school teacher. For 5 years, I taught math and science to both middle and high school students in Florida. When I became an astronaut, the International Space Station became my classroom. This allowed me to share my love for science, technology, engineering, and mathematics with students around the world. My hope are to inspire the next generation of explorers and leaders and to elevate and highlight the teaching profession and its importance to our society. As you learn more about NASA and all that we do, I want you to remember you are a lot like an astronaut aboard the space station right now. As a result of COVID restrictions, many of you are feeling somewhat isolated and forced to interact virtually with family and friends. But hang in there. Your mission is to remain optimistic and resilient. Before signing off, I want to give a shout out to the USVI teachers, faculty, students, and staff, and all of those internationally who are joining us from as far away as Hawaii, Tennessee, Eastern Caribbean, South Africa, India, and Scotland. And finally, to the student presenters from the USVI Cancrine Junior High School, All Saints School, Gift Hill, and Brentwood High School in Tennessee. Thanks for sharing your vision and science with us. All Saints School, Gift Hill, and Brentwood High School in Tennessee. Thanks for sharing your vision and science with us. All Saints School, Gift Hill, and Brentwood High School in Tennessee. Thanks for sharing your vision and science with us.
Good morning. Thank you for that wonderful presentation. Thank you, All Saints. Thank you to our students Adelita Cancrine Intermediate School and our junior high school STEM teachers. Welcome, everybody. My name is Christina Chanos. I'm with the College of Science and Math at the University of the Virgin Islands on behalf of Green Technology, myself and my colleagues, and all of the faculty, staff, and students and related departments. We want to welcome you. Please put your questions in the chat. Tell us what grade, what school, and what teacher you are so that we can call you out. We also have you on Facebook Live and YouTube Live. Now I want to defer to my colleague, Dr. Samuel Garcia. Dr. Garcia, take it away.
Ms. Chanos, thank you very much. And first and foremost, I just want to thank everybody for allowing us the opportunity to come in and connect with you, whether you're at home or at school. It's truly a privilege and an honor to do that. And as you can see, you know, I help and represent NASA Kennedy Space Center. And for the past 60 years, this is our 60th anniversary, NASA Kennedy Space Center has been on the cutting edge of human space exploration. And so today we're really excited to tell you and showcase all the wonderful opportunities that await for you as young people. So it's never too early to start thinking about a career. It's never too, you can never be too young to start exploring what you're interested in. You heard from some of the students, they're doing amazing things. And so you can take that and you can start practicing, you can start finding what you're really passionate about, and you can nurture that passion to help get you to some sort of STEM field where you can contribute to amazing work such as us, such as the what we're doing here at NASA Kennedy Space Center. So what I want to do here at this moment is just, you know, for about 5-10 minutes, talk to you a little bit about some of the careers that are available for you, right? So I'm going to go ahead and get started here, but it's truly a joy and an honor to connect with educators and students. And so I hope that, you know, from today's session, we're able to learn a little bit and think more interest or think more creatively, so we can feel inspired to pursue certain careers and have more confidence in the work that we're doing. Just one second. Okay. I'm sorry, it's just
my God, it's so hot, man. Is it me or is it hot?
It's hot.
Okay.
Okay, so here we go. Hopefully this works. Okay, perfect.
It looks like Dr. Garcia is having a little bit of trouble. So I'm going to go ahead and start my presentation while he gets everything figured out. Welcome. As Dr. Garcia said, we really appreciate you joining us today. My name is Zachary Tursek. I have been working with NASA at the Kennedy Space Center for about 3 years now. And one of my main job functions is to do outreach education for students like yourselves and really kind of, oh, here he is. Here's Dr. Garcia. If Dr. Garcia, if you want to try one more time, we can do that. But I can start my presentation too.
Yeah, let me go ahead and start one more time, Zach. I'm sorry. It's just, this Teams keeps on. It just pushed me out for some reason. I don't know why it did that. But let me give it one more shot. See if we can get a grasp on this. Okay, can y'all see my screen?
Yep, and you should just have to hit the begin presentation button there down at the bottom, and that should be all you need to do.
Yeah, the thing is I have two screens, and then when I do that.
It's jumping to the other one.
It's jumping to the other one.
If you go to, hold on, there's a slide.
While we wait for everyone, please make sure you put your questions in the chat. Please tell us by grade. And school who's on so we can check in. I see we have Seventh Day St. Thomas St. John School here. We have SPROV here. We've got students from All Saints. We've got homeschool students from St. Thomas St. John. Big up to all of our teachers for making time out of their busy days to be with us as we share NASA outreach and STEM careers. Remember, you can be in STEM and actually do communications, graphic arts, law, health, all types of different areas, exercise, science, fancy word for PE. Are we ready, Dr. Garcia?
Yes, I believe so.
Okay, perfect.
Is that visible, Christina?
Yes, sir.
Wonderful. Okay, so let's go ahead and jump into this. So a little bit about me. I am from Texas. I was born and raised from between the Texas and Mexico border. So you see me in those pictures there. I grew up there. I was the first one from my family to go to college. I was first generation college student. My parents were migrant farm workers. They went north to the northern part of the United States during the summer months and fall time to harvest crops, and then they would come back down and then go to school. So my parents were in and out of school all pretty much from until they were like, you know, 11 all the way to like 19. So they did that for many years. And so they wanted a little bit more stability. So they decided that they would not do that anymore. They would find local jobs. And they really focused on providing me an opportunity to go to college, something that they never had. So I took that, I ran with it. I made a lot of mistakes. It was difficult being first generation, but I got through it. Part of it is not, you know, being super intelligent. Just part of it is like being committed, working hard, and, you know, pushing through difficulties. So I learned how to do that. And then I became a teacher. I worked with students. And then I continued my educational journey. And then eventually I got, I earned a doctorate degree also. And here we see some pictures of me. You know, I have a beautiful daughter. She's 11 years old. I love to, you know, teach her and engage her with all things related to NASA and space exploration. And of course, as part of this job, we get to meet astronauts. So I took a picture with Frank Rubio, who's there in one of the rooms out here, astronaut rooms here at Kennedy Space Center. So never thought I would be here. You know, I'm just an example of one person that, you know, didn't have all the privileges in the world, but because I had people who supported me, tried my best at everything I did, and I continue to persevere. And so you can do that as well, right? Even though you have no role models, you know, it is possible. You can become that role model that your family needs. And then, you know, people that come after you will look to you as a source, as an example of what can be done. So my friends, some of us are familiar with NASA, others are not, but NASA, what it stands for is National Aeronautics and Space Administration, right? So at NASA, we do many things, right? We explore space. Our solar system, our galaxy, our universe. NASA also has robotic types of equipment that is exploring our solar system. We have several rovers on Mars right now that are teaching us and demonstrating what Mars is really like in preparation for humans to go to Mars, right, in the future. NASA is also really interested in aeronautics. So if you have a passion for flying or building aircraft of some kind, NASA also focuses heavily, on aeronautics, which is one of the first day. And then we have Earth systems and climate, right? So we see on the bottom right, those are some Earth satellites that are monitoring changes to our Earth, right? So I know that there in the islands, Earth science, Earth climate change is such an important topic. So at NASA, we invest a lot of our resources into exploring and learning more about our planet. So at NASA, we have 10 different centers, and then we have facilities that are scattered all over the entire United States. And so at Kennedy Space Center, if you look at the map, we are in Florida, but all the other red dots there that you see are other centers that you can work for. So if you're interested in flight, there are certain centers that focus on that. If you're looking interested in exploring climate, there are certain centers focus on that, robotics, you name it. There is a little bit of something for everyone at one of these centers. So the next major step is Artemis, right? So we have presenters that are going to share. So I won't take away, you know, I won't go into detail, but Artemis is really this amazing opportunity to be a part of it, to start dreaming, to start working, to start contributing to this amazing vision of going back to the moon and then eventually to Mars. So as part of this team, we have these amazing astronauts. I always like to talk and tell students that, you know, these astronauts have so many skills. They're wonderful people and highly sharp, intelligent. They come from all different backgrounds and they have all different stories and training. But it's, I think it's important to note and to see that there's not one single path to become an astronaut, right? You had Mr. Akaba, who just spoke to you right now. He was a teacher, right? He was a teacher. He loved to teach his math and science. And so he eventually, because of his passion, he eventually became an astronaut. And so, you know, it, just depending on what your passion is, you know, that will give you a pathway to earning a career or making a career for yourself. And who knows, maybe one day that path will take you to NASA and become an astronaut like these wonderful people. So I encourage you to learn about the astronauts, read about their stories, because they had to overcome so many challenges to get where they're at today. So, you know, they're humans just like everybody else, but, you know, it's their drive that set them apart from many other people. So really quickly, I just want to touch on some careers for you. So we know that astronauts are really, really, you know, they're the rock stars of NASA, right? These are individuals that go to space and train, you know, so many hours in preparation to go to space and to do research in microgravity. But, you know, behind the astronauts, we need a team. We need a team that support all the work that they are doing. And so we have scuba divers. Our astronauts train hundreds and hundreds of hours in a large pool in Johnson Space Center, right? That's the only environment that can be, that simulates microgravity of what it's like to be in space. So within that pool, that training, we have scuba divers, right? They help them, they guide them, they support them. And so, you know, that is a career opportunity as well, right? It's useful to know that these careers exist and our astronauts can't do their job without this amazing team behind them. Engineers, right? We have amazing engineers that use their brains, their talents to create some of the spacecraft, some of the satellites that we use to explore space and explore our planet. And we see that, you know, our engineers are amazing people. They come from different backgrounds. And here, I love this photo because it demonstrates that there are many, many females in this role, right? And so we can look and encourage our girls to become engineers because there are many out there, right? And so this is a wonderful field. And we heard some, from some of the students in the video that, you know, they're doing amazing work. And so can you if this is something that you're really passionate and interested about. Scientists, right? We have some in the lab, like this young lady. Some are out in the field exploring the world, right? So, you know, so it's useful to note that not all scientists are in a lab. Some are traveling the world, right? So if you have passion for traveling and learning about the planet, just being outside in nature, you know, you can be a nurse climate scientist. And for my friends that are in agriculture, you know, agriculture is such a huge important, right? We know that our especially now with the pandemic, the food supply, you know, and health has become so important, right? So critical. So we need scientists. And so NASA has these amazing scientists that are working really hard to figure out the best ways of growing crops here on Earth, but also in space, right? Eventually we want to go to Mars. So a key thing that we're going to need is food, right? So we have these wonderful astrobiologists that are, and plant scientists that are figuring out, you know, what plants grow best and how they grow best in space. We have computer programmers. You know, a lot of us are interested in gaming, working with software, and so we need programmers as well. I see this young man, He's been working really hard on his laptop there. And so we need programmers that take care of our computers, that monitor systems, that help us do the work that we're able to do. Because without our technology, it's really hard to do the work that we do. Writers, if you have a passion for writing, we need authors. We need people that write articles and journals and, news release individuals. So we have a passion in individuals like these two that help tell the story of NASA. We have business people, accountants, and then we have artists, right? I really want to focus on the art here because without the art, we couldn't really tell the story of space, right? And you see these posters and you think about to yourself, well, how do artists capture this amazing, what we really can't see, right? It's they use data, they work with engineers and scientists, and they start painting a picture of what these planets look like, right? Based on what we're able to collect from telescopes and other instruments. And so we have these beautiful posters, right? And so this helps tell the NASA story. And you see this lady, this is an artist, right? And she's there in her office, she's designing, she's a graphic designer. And so she helps tell this wonderful story visually, right? So if you have a passion for art, hey, there's definitely an opportunity for you to contribute and work with NASA. And this isn't something new. This is something that has been going on since the 1960s. And you see this sci-fi type of looking thing. And so this program, this art was created back in the 1960s and 70s. So we need people who can think like this and help us visualize what we haven't done yet. I mean, that's an amazing skill set when you really, really, truly think about it. And I just want to showcase some of these other things, right? Some of us are very familiar with the mission patches, right? Every mission that goes to space has a little patch like you see on the top of the screen, right? So we need artists to help develop these mission patches. And at the bottom, we have this wonderful mural, right? That this gentleman did, many years ago. And this is at one of the NASA centers. So art is so important, right? We can't forget in STEM, we can't forget the A, STEAM, in art. And so I just encourage you to, if you have a passion for art, follow it, because even in NASA, artists are so valuable and key contributors to the work that we do. Photographers, people love to take photographs. Here we see a shot of a man flying in a plane, taking shots of the planet, different sites up there, hundreds, thousands of feet in the air. So photographers are really important. And that's something to highlight as well. And of course, educators, right? People are passionate about education, such as myself. We talk to students, we work with teachers, and we work with community members and just showcase all the wonderful resources that are available for them. So a little bit of everything is available and definitely a career opportunity for all at NASA. But really, when it comes down to students are so important, right? We have, starting at the age of 16, you can start applying for internships at NASA. We need students, we need young people to come in with creative ideas, with energy, with passion, and contribute your skill sets to the work that we are doing, because without subsequent generations, we wouldn't be able to do the things that we're doing or meet the goals that we want to meet. And so one final activity, I just want you, in your spare time, educators, students, or teachers, if you have a spare time in your classroom, or you just want to assign something that's fun and engaging, I encourage you to draw Artemis. Artemis is of course, our Moon to Mars mission. And so our students, our young people learn about Artemis through drawing, right? So this is something that you can watch at home, you can do at home, you can watch some tutorials, and you can learn how to draw Artemis and its different components. So it's really fun. It's a little challenging, but you'll learn a lot through this activity. And I think that concludes my time with you all. But again, I just encourage you to pursue something that you're interested in. Learn right now, explore, and because there are many pathways that can lead you to NASA. So thank you for your time, and I'll be happy to answer any questions later if time allows. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Garcia. I think we have our next speaker ready, and I'll just take a moment to introduce Kat Toon. She is a program analyst with Exploration Ground Systems, and I'll just turn it over to her and we'll get started.
Good morning. Thanks, Zach. Dr. Garcia did a wonderful job introducing NASA as a whole and all the opportunities that are out here. And what I'm going to talk to you about today is about the Artemis program that Dr. Garcia was discussing, and then my role within that, working within Exploration Ground Systems, because it takes a lot to build a rocket. It doesn't just come prepackaged all together. It takes a lot to get there. So before I dive into what we do here with Exploration Ground Systems out at Kennedy Space Center in Florida, I'll tell you a little bit about myself. So my name is Katherine Toon. At work, everybody calls me Kat. It's just a lot easier. I graduated from the University of Central Florida and we lost the presentation, Zach. That's okay, I know about myself. So I graduated in 2013 from the University of Central Florida with a bachelor's degree in elementary education. And so I used to be a teacher too. I taught for about 4 years, and then I came and joined Exploration Ground Systems as a contractor in 2017. Well, okay, perfect, thanks, Zach. And while I was teaching, I was really, I loved science. And so one of the things that I did was help do our STEM and science clubs at our school. And then in those two pictures, the one with the baby, that's my baby who's not a baby anymore. He's 3, super big. But you can see one of the launch pads behind me. That one's not ours. That one's not Exploration Ground Systems. And I'm sorry, Zach, did you have? Okay. And then the picture on the other side of the screen with the red shirt is me sitting in front of our mobile launcher. And we're going to talk about our mobile launcher more today, but that's a picture of it in real life. So we can go to the next slide, please. That would be great. Okay, so from 2017 to 2020, I was doing meeting support. So I'm someone who likes helping coordinate things. I pay a lot of attention to detail. I'm very fast at typing. So that was a super awesome role for me to be in. And then as I learned more, I found a new position, which is what I'm doing now, as a program analyst, where I read through lots and lots of documents. I get to be kind of like a detective and trying to find who said what and why we said that. And it's a really fun job. So in the two pictures that you see, and the one on the bottom, you see this giant building behind me, which I have a copy of behind me now, but in the picture too, called the Vehicle Assembly Building, the VAB. And we're going to talk more about that later. And then the picture on the right side with me and the two other ladies, we're standing and being kind of silly, standing inside of the Launch Control Center, the LCC. And again, we'll talk about that more in a minute. Okay, so like Mr. Garcia talked about, one of the missions that we have coming up is the Artemis Manifest. A manifest is just a fancy term for when you have a bunch of different activities going on at once, and they're all kind of related. So what we're going to talk about today is how we at Exploration Ground Systems get us ready to go back to the moon and then ultimately to Mars, because it takes a lot of ground support for us to be able to launch a rocket. And so the first part of it is the actual rocket itself. So as you can see that, it comes in a bunch of different parts. And we had to put it together. So if you're someone who likes Legos and you want to work for NASA, that's perfect, because essentially we're doing giant Legos that are actually rocket parts and the booster pieces. So it comes to us and it gets to us by train. It gets to us by barge. Some of it we get shipped here by cargo truck and we put together, but we have to stack all these different pieces. So at the bottom, you see these two white parts, and those are called solid rocket boosters. So if you're someone who likes fireworks, you like playing with fireworks with adult supervision, That's something that you might like doing over here with NASA, is helping be one of our engine controller or our one of our engineers who works with the engine controllers, or if you like working with solid rocket boosters, helping us get that together and getting all the fuel and everything else. And then the big orange part on top of the solid rocket boosters is called the core stage. That holds a lot of fuel that's needed to help us break out of low Earth atmosphere, the Earth's gravitational pull, and get onto our way to the moon and then ultimately to Mars. And then on the left, the guy that's kind of tilting over, that is our Orion crew vehicle or Orion crew capsule. And with our second mission, Artemis 2, we're actually going to have astronauts on board. We have Artemis 1 coming up this year. And with that one, it'll kind of be like a test flight. We want to make sure things work perfect before we put astronauts and people into our rocket and get ready to go to the moon and then to Mars. So what's really cool is you see kind of this little hat on the Orion crew capsule. That's called the launch abort system. And so what that does is if there's an issue, it'll help detach the crew capsule from the rocket and get them to safety. And if everything goes according to plan, there's no issues at all, which is what we hope for and what we train for, it will help us whenever we're on our flight path to the moon to give us a little extra boost. So we get all those pieces and now we have to put them together somewhere. And this is where Vabulous, the Vehicle Assembly Building, or VAB, which in real life is a picture of it in real life is behind me. Well, that's a giant, like a giant garage. It's a giant, technically one-story building, and that's where we assemble and put together and integrate or stack the rocket and get it ready to roll out to the pad. And while it's there, we have to assemble it onto something, right? We can't just put it together and then expect it to hop over to the launch pad. So that's where we have the guy in the bottom picture, the crawler, and that you can see has these giant wheels and belted wheels, kind of like a tank, that will help us transport the rocket all the way out to the pad. All right, so whenever we are stacking our rocket, not only do we want it on the crawler, right, because that's going to drive it out to the pad, but we can't just stick a rocket on a giant car, right? It would fall over. We don't want that to happen. So that's why we have this picture down here, this guy Moby, which is short for mobile launcher. So what that does is it helps keep the vehicle or the rocket upright. And it also has all these arms and connections or umbilicals that attach to the rocket to help provide fuel, to help keep it upright prior to it launching. That one is a giant, it's a big old thing of steel. It doesn't look like much, but oh my goodness, it has so many different parts, components, and pieces that are necessary for us to launch. All right, so whenever we are all stacked and ready to go, we have to take it on the crawler, right? That thing with the big wheels, and then with the mobile launcher on top of the crawler helping hold up the rocket. So the mobile launcher, the crawler, because it has this giant mobile launcher on it that's very heavy, and the rocket sitting on top of it, it has to go really, really, really slow. So the fastest that it'll go is about 2 miles an hour. When it's unloaded and while it's loaded, meaning it has the mobile launcher and the rocket on it, it goes about 1 mile an hour. So you would be able to run faster than the crawler transporter. My babies would be able to run faster than the crawler transporter. A mouse, but a turtle would probably not be able to beat the crawler transporter in a race out to the launch pad. And so, like we said, once we get out to the launch pad, you'll notice there's not a lot of buildings around there because that is a big old area for us to launch our rockets. And we don't want a lot of people out there or close by because it is so loud. And there's a lot of, like, we're a couple of, about 2 miles away from the launch pad. And whenever we have a launch. You can feel it in your body starting to like shake. That's how intense it is. It's very cool. So we get everything out to the launch pad, and that is where we will launch our rocket. So what we're doing, right, we have a couple of different missions with Artemis. The first one, like I said, is kind of like a test, a practice run without any astronauts. And we'll go and we'll circle around the moon, and then we will come back to Earth. And then with Artemis 2, we'll do that again, but with people. And so whenever we're ready to launch, our launch director, Charlie Blackwell Thompson, and she's a wonderful person, will give us the go for launch. So she'll do the 3, 2, 1, you're clear to lift off. And our rocket will start to go in those, the boosters on the side, the white pieces, and then the core stage all help us to get up and out from Earth, launching from Kennedy Space Center, all the way up into the atmosphere to get going, past the atmosphere into space and onto the moon. All right, so it takes us about 3 days to get to the moon, right? So we'll get to the moon, it'll, our rocket will go the furthest, ultimately when we have our people in it, in Artemis 2, it'll go past the moon, the furthest point past the Earth that humans have been yet. So that's really exciting for us. So when we have our rocket, it'll go, and ultimately later on in the Artemis manifest, we will land on the moon, we'll do a lot of harvesting there, some testing, and ultimately practicing what it would be like to go to Mars. Like I said, it takes us 3 days to get to the moon, and that's just one way, so it also takes us 3 days to get back. But to get to Mars, right, Mars is so much further away from us than the moon is, it takes 9 months just to get to Mars. So us going to the moon will help us practice working and living kind of close to home, 3 days away, before we do the big trip over to Mars. So once we're there and everything else, we need to get our astronauts and our crew and everyone back safely to Earth. So as the rocket's leaving Earth, the boosters will come off, the core stage will come off, the big orange part. And then like we talked about it, that kind of hat looking thing that's on top of their Orion crew capsule, that will also have come off. And whenever we're ready to go back to Earth, it'll be, you see kind of that in the top right of the picture, you see, oh shoot, that's our crew capsule with the parachutes coming out. So that'll come, and there's lots of parachutes and everything else, and then it'll splash down into the ocean. And if you're somebody who wants to work with the Navy and still work with NASA, I got you, because we have our recovery team. So we partner with the Navy, and they watch and they track and see where the crew capsule is going to splash down. And then they go, and we have to make sure that we have a special team of scuba divers and everything else to make sure that everything's okay with the vehicle and with the astronauts with Artemis 2. Make sure that fuel isn't leaking and that everything's good to go. And then they'll go and take some pictures underneath, and then we'll go and recover our crew and recover the capsule and bring it back on board to the naval vessel. So all these different parts, right? We had the rocket that comes to us in parts and pieces, like we talked about. So if you like Legos, basically a giant Legos all day long. So I love working here because I love Legos. Fireworks, like we talked about, with the boosters. Again, if you like fireworks, come and work with us because those are essentially giant fireworks. And then the engines themselves, as you're someone who wants to be a mechanic, or you like cars and you like helping somebody do all that stuff, we need you as our rocket engineers or engine mechanics and everything else. We actually have people that drive that really big thing, the crawler transporter that goes super, super slow. We have people that have to drive that and train engineers to do that. And like I said, we also have our recovery team. And then we have tons of folks like myself, management analysts, who help dig through data and help us find documentation when needed. We have folks like Dr. Garcia talked about in lots of detail, that we need people who are good with graphic design. So if you're someone who likes coding, You're someone who likes problem solving. You're someone who's really good at communicating with a team and working together. You could be one of our NASA test directors who sit in the Launch Control Center with Charlie Beckwell Thompson working out and checking on the vehicle and the crew prior to launch. So there's tons and tons and tons of different jobs. So if you're someone who, you know, you think you have to be good at math and science to work at NASA, although that's great, and we definitely want people who love math and science, that's not the only jobs we have out here. We need all different interests out here working with us and helping NASA and helping us get to the moon and then to Mars as well. And then I think that does it for the majority of my portion of the presentation. I wanted to leave a good bit of time for questions, because I'm sure folks have tons and tons of questions, and I want myself and Zach and Dr. Garcia to be able to help answer all the wonderful questions that I'm sure you have. So with that being said, if you have questions and you want to drop them in the chat, that's probably the easiest place for Dr. Garcia and I to answer your questions.
Christina, do you have any questions yet? All right, well, I'll go ahead and ask a question.
Sure.
I think I'd like to know how astronauts eat in space.
That's a good one. So we have lots of different options. Right now at the International Space Station, they actually do have, it's not a greenhouse, but it kind of works like that. They're growing, they harvested peppers a couple of months back and everything else. So they're actually able to grow some crops, some fruits and veggies over on the International Space Station. But another thing that our folks do is our astronauts work with some of our food engineers and food scientists. And they actually, months ahead, state what different meals that they want. And then the folks down back on Earth and in our food sciences kitchen actually help create those meals. And they dehydrate or remove the water from it. So when astronauts are ready to eat, they can just add a little bit of water to it. One big thing that you'll notice is a lot of our astronauts eat on tortillas. That's easy to add things to roll it up and keep contained, because you don't want all of this food and everything and ooey gooey stuff leaking out. Because remember, there's not a lot of gravity up there, so it'll float around, and the last thing you want is ketchup going in your eye or hitting one of the instruments. That was a great question, Zach. Thank you.
Yeah, I saw one in the chat there that said how teachers access resources for lower grades. So a great place to start is our curricula, which is called Next Gen STEM, and it's broken down in three areas, including Earth, Moon, and then aeronautics. And so by clicking that particular link that I just shared, you can identify what area, what focus you'd like to do, and then you know it'll take you to a certain page there that is broken down by grade levels. And so this is a great place to start. We know that NASA has tremendous, you know, years and years, decades worth of resources for teachers and students. So you can get kind of lost. Even I get lost in the midst of so many different activities. And so, these are like the brand new hot off the press type of activities. And so these are the ones that are, you know, aligned with a lot of the missions that are going on right now. So I recommend that. I recommend that particular website, and it's a great place to start. And by the time you know it, you know, you're going to come across hundreds of other links that you're going to want to save and add to your saved searches, right? So I think that's a great place to start.
So Ms. Lewis would like to know, how do astronauts sleep?
So that's a really good question. So our astronauts right now at the International Space Station, they kind of have these like sleeping bags, that are attached, and the astronauts get in there and they zip up and they're able to kind of be attached. And when you're looking at it, it looks like they're having to sleep, like standing up. But remember, there's not a whole lot of gravity up there. So they are, it doesn't feel like they're standing up to them. And then as far as our crew with Orion, they'll be strapped into their seats or be able to move around a little bit. But I imagine for sleeping, they would probably be strapped in. Yes, and we love questions. So please, please, please don't hesitate to ask.
I have one. I'm in sixth grade and I'm a homeschooler. What do they eat?
So like we answered that one a little bit. So they have a grow lab up at the International Space Station, and there they have different fruits and veggies. They just harvested a couple months back the peppers, and they were able to eat those. And they do coordinate with our food scientist prior to their missions to pick out what foods that they want to have, and they dehydrate or remove the water from the food, and to where parts of it the astronauts can rehydrate to eat. A lot of the times they will utilize tortillas and put the food in tortillas or tortilla and peanut butter sandwiches and roll that up and have it contained, because we don't want food floating around out in space and getting on our instruments or getting on our people.
Okay, Miss Lewis's class has another question. She would like to know, or her students would like to know, how astronauts take showers in space.
Mr. Garcia, or Dr. Garcia, you want to handle that one, or you want me to take it? Okay. Again, very carefully. Like we said, there's, because of the very limited amount of gravity that they have up there, they can't just jump in the shower and have it streaming down, because the water wouldn't flow down. It would kind of just bubble up and float around. So a big thing that we've seen in our videos is that they'll utilize, and Zach put a great video in the chat for y'all to check out, but they'll utilize a little bit of water and then put that on some, it'll kind of hover on the washcloth and use that to wash their face and their hair. Again, that video is a really, really good example. You'll see how her hair kind of floating all around, just to give you another glimpse as to the limitations of gravity up there.
Okay, Seventh-day Adventist School, welcome everyone. We know the lower grades are here. Thank you for being here. They would like to know, they understand that it takes approximately 9 months to get to Mars. How do astronauts survive that trip? What do they do?
That's a really loaded question. That's a good question. So our capsule and everything else is geared to take into account all these different factors that our astronauts will face, such as radiation and what have you. So it takes a big rocket to launch a big vehicle like that, or a big crew capsule. They'll have the food and resources that they need on the, or with them in the crew capsule and everything else. And I mean, we'll see. We have some of the best minds in the world. And like I said, that's a really loaded question. There's a lot of technical details that go into that, that I'm not even quite sure how to answer. It boggles my mind too, which is why we need students like you to come and work with us to help us problem solve and figure out all these great details and thinking about the best ways for them to shower going that long over to Mars. But another thing to consider is that our astronauts at the International Space Station, I think the long, I would have to double check, but there's been folks that have been up there for just shy or just over a year at a time. So we're able to study and take their vitals and see, you know, how that, you know, the decreased gravity and everything else, the impacts it has on them, and how to best prepare our upcoming astronauts for going to Mars. So everything we do, like I said, going back to the moon and practicing working away from Earth, the work that they've done at the International Space Station, information that we get from Hubble, that we're going to get from James Webb, all these other things are going to help us build our knowledge base to help prepare our astronauts and our crew for working and living in deep space. That was a really good question. Thank you.
So Nunu from homeschool in St. Thomas, St. John wants to know if it's cramped in a sleeping environment and is exercise necessary?
So with the ISS, with the International Space Station, they're a little bit more spread out than they would be, say, in the Orion crew capsule. With the crew capsule, the inside's kind of the size of a small bus. So they have room, but you got to be really good friends and working and communicating together, being stuck in a pretty tight space. But they do have equipment where they're able to simulate gravity and everything else for the astronauts to run and keep up their cardiovascular health and everything else. Because you're right, it's not like they can go outside and go for a quick walk to exercise. But I'm going to have to get back to you with a little more detail on that question. Thank you.
So William from homeschool St. Thomas St. John, he's 11 years old, and he indicates when you are on Earth and you are upside down, it affects your blood flow. So when you're in space with no gravity, how does it affect your blood flow?
I'll let you take that one, Dr. Garcia.
Oh, that's a great question. And as if you watch some of the videos, some of the astronauts speak to that, they mention that since they're orbiting Earth, you know, they're in a constant state of free fall, right? And so to them, their orientation, they don't have one because they're always constantly falling. And so it takes them about, one of the astronauts mentioned it took that particular person about 3 days to get used to, you know, having no sense of gravity or a very minimal sense of gravity. And so it does affect their blood flow, but not in the sense that, you know, the blood rushes to their head like the way we do. It's just that they can't really find an orientation, right? So they're in a constant state of free fall. And so they got to first get adjusted to microgravity and then understand that, you know, there is no up or down, or, you know, it just depends on, you know, what they're doing at the moment and where their location is at. But other than that, it does take a couple of days to get adjusted. You know, it can you imagine that, you know, touching ground or something? You know, it has that sense, right? And so it's really odd the way they explain it. You know, and I think it's something that you can't really understand until you go through it yourself, right? So I know that some of us have gone on roller coaster rides. And the astronauts mentioned that's kind of the sense that they feel all the time because they're like falling over, you know, the Earth or orbiting around the Earth, and they have this sensation in their stomach. And that's the way they explain it. And they're like, oh, after about the third day, you kind of get used to it, right? But imagine that feeling over and over and over again. So it's pretty crazy and incredible when you think about it.
Okay, so Miss Lewis from Sprav School, her group of kids have a question. They want to know, what do astronauts do in their spare time in space? Reading, playing games, music, what do they do?
A lot of the astronauts mentioned that during their downtime, they like to spend it talking with family and friends here on Earth. Any chance they get, they talk to their children, their spouses, their parents. So that's really important. Another thing is that, you know, they like to, of course, do their own thing, whether it's listen to music, whether it's read a book. And others, they just like to go to the cupola, which is the little opening that the astronauts have, the little window that they get to see Earth, and they just like to sit there and admire the Earth, you know, in their spare time. So it just depends. But astronauts really like to connect with family, and just, you know, have a moment to themselves to view the Earth from space.
Okay, this is for the retired folks in the back row who are watching on Facebook Live from the beautiful community of Upland in California. And they would like to know, they're up early, and they would like to know if astronauts are allowed to have sweets and coffee in space.
Dr. Garcia, I'll let you handle that one. You're a bit more familiar with our ISS folks as opposed to me with Artemis.
Yeah, that's gotcha. Sorry. So that's a wonderful question. And the answer is yes. The astronauts have a wonderful selection of different types of food that are prepackaged. And, you know, sometimes you see videos of the astronauts eating like M&Ms in space. You know, they toss it and then they go and chase after it. Or is it Skittles? You know, some sort of like candy like that. They do enjoy sweets. I know that in special occasions, like whether it's Christmas or Thanksgiving, they have little desserts of some kind. And some of us, you know, if you have been fortunate enough to go to, for example, a space center, you see that there's astronaut ice cream that's like dehydrated. So they have treats like that available for them. And the beverages as well. They have different types, but it just come in a certain pouch, right? And so they don't have the opportunity to really heat, you know, boil water like the way we do. They have certain systems like microwaves, things like that, that allow them to heat certain types of prepackaged foods and condiments and that sort of thing. But, you know, they have pretty much a lot of the same things that we have in space. It's just packaged in a different way for space.
Okay, one of our homeschoolers, Nunu, has another question. The homeschool group in St. Thomas, St. John would like to know, how do you use the bathroom, toothpaste, brushing your teeth, things of that nature? How does that all work in space?
I'm so glad they asked. That's one of my favorite questions to get. Because I remember I was really lucky and got to go to space camp when I was in elementary school, and that was something that I was like obsessed with. So I understand the interest. But we actually have to train our astronauts how to go to the bathroom in space. Like we know, very reduced level gravity up there. So when you go to the potty, you can't just go normal because it would just come back up and that would be just a very gross, messy situation. So they actually have to practice and there's a lot of suction involved. They actually have to get trained. There's mirrors that they have to use to help them see how and where to go to the bathroom.
Okay, I got another question on text and I don't recognize the number, so I apologize. But they want to know if an asteroid goes by a spaceship or the International Space Station, can you hear it, like the hurricanes or the wind that devastated the states over the last couple of weeks on the East Coast and the West Coast? Good question.
Dr. Garcia, I'm going to have to defer to you on that one.
Yeah, of course. That's a great question, and it depends, right? I know that these asteroids come in different sizes and shapes. Some of them come close, right? I mean, close, which is a few, you know, maybe several millions of miles, but that's close enough to be considered something dangerous, right? So when our astronauts are on the ISS, there's some, you know, one thing that people are doing is monitoring every single second of what's happening in space. So we have ground controllers that are communicating with astronauts, even while astronauts are asleep. They're making sure that that their environment, their home is safe. So I know that recently there was an incident where they had to readjust the ISS because of potential danger, right? There's some space debris out there. And so anything that, you know, may come close, you know, is a cause for alarm. So they take great precautions into keeping our astronauts healthy and safe up there, especially, you know, with, you know, micrometeorites and asteroids and things of that nature. because anything that is traveling in space is coming at a tremendous speed, at velocity, so it can puncture right through and it can cause tremendous damage and to the safety and health of our astronauts. And so I know when astronauts go into spacewalk, you know, they go out in space, they really can't hear anything, really, right? Because it's like a vacuum of some sort. And so, you know, it travels very differently, the sound does. And so I would imagine that, you know, the sensation, it would be very different because there's no, you know, there's no gravity or there's a microgravity. And so what you and I hear and hear now would, you know, we wouldn't experience it the same as in space. So very different environments, but very, very highly unlikely that they would sense it and feel the way we'd normally feel here on Earth just because of those conditions.
And then there was,
go ahead.
I was going to say there was one statement in the chat that I really wanted to address about motivating some of our younger folks, especially our kindergartners, to start thinking in the direction of space and other space exploration and other similar technologies. And what I want to say to, no matter how old you are, you yourself are a scientist. The main job of a scientist is to ask questions. What is that? Why is it that color? What does it do? You know, exploring things with your hands, building things, playing, you know, I have two little boys and it is all about Legos and magnet blocks, you know, building things, figuring out how it works, how to put it together. So if you're someone who likes to ask those questions, you like to talk, you like to figure things out, we need you. There's going to be problems that Dr. Garcia and I have never thought of in our wildest dreams. I would have never thought, you know, hey, what do astronauts need to do to be entertained? You know, they have so many jobs that they have to do. I never would have thought, hey, maybe, you know, they can't bring cards because the cards would, you know, go everywhere. Maybe they can and they can Velcro it down. So there's a lot of questions that need to be asked that, as smart as all the folks are that work at NASA and the various contracts and all the different centers, you know, there's so many questions that we don't even, haven't even thought to ask yet. So that my kindergarten pals, just keep asking questions. You know, we need y'all to come up and help us figure out new problems and getting to Mars and what to do on Mars and, you know, all those other fun things and going to other planets as well.
Thank you. That question was from St. Thomas St. John Seventh Day Adventist School. Very excited to have you answer that. We have a question from Ms. D'Souza, who's a counselor at Sprague Elementary and Junior High School on the beautiful island of St. John. And she would like to know if you need counselors at NASA, educational counselors or otherwise, and how folks can find employment opportunities. I believe that's usajobs.gov, yes? I'll put it in the chat. But can you answer the question about teachers and educators and counselors?
Yeah, Dr. Garcia knows all about all the opportunities that we have here, so I'll let him handle that one.
Awesome, thank you, Kat. And yes, the answer is yes, yes, and yes. And so, I mean, when you think about the work that we do, you know, especially now, you know, mental health, emotional health is so critical, right? And so we have some, especially right now during what we're going through, which is being in isolation, very similar to what the astronauts go through in space. We do need counselors. We need counselors of all kind to help us handle these situations, right? And so I know that our astronauts have access to all, you know, these very talented counselors because when they're in space, I mean, you know, they're in isolation for months, 6 months at a time. And so they need to talk through, they need to understand, process certain feelings and emotions and make sense of what they're experiencing. And so, yes, there's a dedicated team of medical staff at every center, across the agency that are supporting this important work. And then educators too, like myself, and that do outreach, that connect with students and teachers and community members. And so we need outreach people to go out and share the work that NASA is doing, get them involved, get them engaged, and get them inspired to want to contribute to the work that we're doing at NASA.
Great. So Zach, if you could come on, we have 5 minutes left and I have one question for each one of you about your jobs, your careers. This is the hot seat, Zach. If you could open up your camera, you are not getting away.
Give me 1 second.
Okay, so we will start with you, Miss Kat. What is it like being a woman in science and engineering and being a young mom? Can you talk about the difficulties, the challenges, and the best parts?
Oh my goodness. Well, so being a woman, you would think that I'm greatly outnumbered, but there are a lot of women that work with NASA, be it engineers or scientists, management analysts like myself, astronauts, you know, regardless of your gender or however you identify, you know, we need your mind. We need what unique experiences you bring to the table. So like you said, being a working mom, you know, my kids are 3 and 1.5. So it's a lot. And, you know, juggling that, thankfully, I'm very fortunate to where I have daycare, where I'm able to take the kids who, and they love going there. And so where, when I'm working, I'm able to focus at home. The hardest part, I think with any job, if I'm being honest, is being sure of yourself and being confident in what you do and what you can, and what you contribute, especially at NASA. Although you think, you know, a lot of folks think like, oh my God, you must be crazy brilliant. And like you're probably going into the rocket every day and hanging out with astronauts, you know, I like to think I'm pretty smart. I'm not going into the rocket. That's not, you know, what my job entails. I get to see it. I'm very blessed and fortunate that I'm able to see it and see those cool things. But, you know, you have to be confident in yourself and what you bring to the table and the unique experiences that you have to where I can help contribute to my team and to the success of NASA as a whole. And the coolest part, it has to be, you know, working at Kennedy Space Center, we get to see a lot of cool stuff because this is where we launch. So seeing a rocket launch is way up there. But I think the coolest thing for me right now is being able to go into the vehicle assembly building. Again, that really big building that's pictured behind me where we stack and integrate the rocket, all the parts and pieces, and seeing it come together in stages and now being able to go there and actually see it all put together in person. And I mean, I can't wait for when we have our wet dress rehearsal, when we're rolling to pad, and then ultimately whenever we're launching, because this has been a lot of work in the making.
Thank you. Dr. Garcia, as a minority, can you talk about, it's really exciting to know that women are welcome to the table at NASA, but talk about minorities, specifically Black and Brown people, first generation kids who may be interested in pursuing science in college and whose parents are, you know, will sacrifice a great deal to get them there. What is the coolest thing about your job and your journey?
Oh, that's a wonderful question. And I'm going to try my best to answer it. So I think, you know, part of my journey, what I've learned along the way is that connects with a lot of what Kat just mentioned. It says really believing in yourself. You know, we have teachers that guide us and support us. We have parents and aunts and uncles and, you know, you name it, our family that do their best to sacrifice for us, you know, and one way we can pay that forward is, you know, taking a step further, like achieving something that they were unable to achieve because of whatever conditions or lack of opportunities they face. So I think part of it is always having a drive, you know, to prove not only myself, but to make those individuals that supported me proud of us, of what we're doing. Because when one of us celebrates, you know, when one of us achieves something, we all celebrate together. That's the way I felt when I graduated from college. It was like my whole family had just graduated from college. It was a huge moment, you know. People were crying. People were so happy, right? So it's like a shared experience. It's a community experience. And so for young people, I mean, what you're doing, what you possibly you're doing, especially if you're a student of color, You know, you have the chance to do something really special for your family and something that will change the course of your family's history forever. And so being, you know, a person of color at NASA, what I've learned is that, you know, we all have something to share and contribute. So my perspective is unique, right? Something that maybe others will not bring. So that goes to show that we're all special and that we can all contribute in some way, somehow. And so collectively, we're able to be, you know, stronger and do more things. But always be mindful that that you have more strengths than weaknesses. Like, really, what you think is a weakness, in reality, it's not. It's truly an asset. And so if you come from, you know, like a certain community, from a certain section from the community that's not really popular, or people don't understand or have perceptions about, that's truly an asset, because you know what it's like there, and then you can go back and improve, you know, what people are doing, the life, people's lives in that region. Why? Because you have the heart to do that. And so I think that, you know, part of my journey is making sure that, you know, yes, my family is proud of me, but then that I use what I can to help, you know, and encourage other people to do the same like me. And so I'm a voice, just one voice, to help encourage and show and tell people like, hey, you can do it, or I can do it, it's possible. And so, you know, we all have a responsibility to do that and help, you know, continue, you know, motivating others and inspiring others to do the same.
Great. And Zach, one question for you as we wrap this up. You are an early career NASA scientist and contributor. Can you talk about your journey briefly in getting there? And what is, besides working with UVI, what is the coolest thing that you get to do?
Well, I had a probably unique experience coming to the Kennedy Space Center. So for many years, I was a professional chef. I worked at a lot of different restaurants and, you know, had the opportunity to make, you know, dishes from all over the world. I worked at a German restaurant for a few years and many other restaurants in my 20s. And but I did receive a degree from the University of Central Florida in communications. And so at some point I decided that maybe, you know, being a chef wasn't something I wanted to do forever. And so I started looking for jobs at the Kennedy Space Center. And about 3 years ago, I got a job doing internal communications. I managed one of our websites. So I managed all the content that came through it. And now I'm doing outreach. So I'm getting the opportunity to meet students and subject matter experts from all over the country, all over the nation, and making a lot of great connections with teachers and students, like I mentioned, and astronauts and other people at NASA who contribute to the missions in various ways. So that's kind of my story and how I ended up where I'm at. And I think it's a great example of, you know, you just because you start your career one way, that doesn't mean that you're stuck. You know, if you end up working one job when you get out of high school or when you're going to college, you're not stuck in doing one thing. You can always change your path. You can choose to do something different. And if you're mindful and you're intentional about the things that you choose to do, you're going to be successful. And so I think I'm a great example of that. So thank you.
Awesome. Thank you all for a lovely presentation. Thank you to all our schools, teachers, faculty, and staff. On behalf of the University of the Virgin Islands College of Science and Math and Caribbean Green Technology Center, thanks for attending, and we hope to see you next year.
Yay.
Hey, one quick thing. While folks are jumping off or jumping on, you know, although we do talk a lot about college and everything else, and that's, you know, our experiences that Zach, Dr. Garcia, and I have had, we do have a lot of positions out here that if college is not in the cards for you, or that is not on your path right now, you can still work out at NASA. We have plenty of technical positions that we have a huge need and those require a technical school and not necessarily a standard college degree. So please, if you are someone that's like, college is out of the cards for me and I want to work at NASA, please, please, please don't rule us out, because we still absolutely need you. You are essential. And thank you so much for letting us join you. I know that I had a blast. I'm sure so did Dr. Garcia and Zach. We love doing outreach, so thank you so much.
Great. We'll be back at 10:45 with round two. Thanks, everyone.
Right. Bye, everyone.
Bye. Adios.
Bye. Thank you.
Welcome. My name is David Hall. I am the president of the University of the Virgin Islands, and I want to welcome all of you to this global outreach program with the focus on STEM. The University of the Virgin Islands is proud to partner with NASA in supporting this effort. It is critical to the Virgin Islands, to this nation, and to the world. I want to first thank NASA for all of the support it has provided down through the years to the University of the Virgin Islands. We would not have a physics program without their support, and we are proud to be one of the few HBCUs in the nation that offer degrees in physics to our students. Second, I want to thank Dr. David Morris, one of our faculty members who has been a pioneer for us in creating the physics program, for taking our observatory, our Edelman Observatory, to an entirely different level, and for all of the work he has done with NASA and forming this partnership. I also want to thank the leaders of our Caribbean Center for Green Technology, Greg Wannell, Ms. Chans, Christina Chans, for their work around climate change, which is a focus of this outreach effort. But more importantly, I want to thank and welcome all of the students who will be participating in this gathering, especially those from the Virgin Islands, who we are very proud to have them participate, but the individuals from around the world who will be participating in this global outreach effort are welcomed and should be applauded. STEM and the development of more talent in STEM fields is not only critical to the growth of this nation, but critical to the growth of the world. We will not be able to provide the leaders for economic development, for innovation, if we do not have the requisite number of students in STEM fields. But it is not just economic development and innovation, but as the COVID pandemic has demonstrated to us, we need individuals who are knowledgeable in the healthcare arena, knowledgeable about infectious diseases and all of the ramifications that come from healthcare challenges. These are STEM fields, and we believe that it is important to inspire students at an early age to get them aware of the various career paths and to pursue these areas. And so finally, I want to just indicate that we are proud to host this event. The university, we pride ourselves in trying to be a leader in STEM development, and not just STEM development in general, but especially among those students and groups who are often absent from STEM fields. Unless we are able to tap into all of the resources that are available in our nation and in the world, we will not be able to meet the challenges that we face. And this gathering and this university and NASA are deeply committed to that vision. Welcome. I hope the next few days will be enlightening, inspiring, and will leave a mark on each of you. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Mirza Beg, eighth grade student, and I love physics.
Hi, I'm Shalani Talaman, eighth grade student, and I love biology.
Hi, I'm Sanaya King. I'm an eighth grade student, and I love chemistry.
And we are the UVI Water Ambassadors and Future Scientists of Adelita Cancrine Junior High School.
Hi, my name is Cecile Penn, and I am a science teacher at the Adelita Cancrine Intermediate and Junior High School. I have been involved with UVI and the Water Ambassadors Program for more than 8 years. On behalf of UVI President Dr. Hall, the College of Science and Math, and UVI Caribbean Green Technology Center, we want to welcome our colleagues at school across the territory, nationally and internationally.
Let me bring you on a short tour of St. Thomas Pineapple Point at St. John Trunk Bay, United States, Virgin Islands.
Notice the clear blue seas and the beautiful beaches that describe Hull, Megan's, and Trunk Bay. Join me as I take you on a virtual tour of the USVI. Megan's Bay. The water is usually very calm with no waves of current. Great for floating along and for swimming. The bay deepens gradually from shore, making it perfect for small children. Snorkeling is possible along the rocky coast. However, Megan's Bay is not known for good snorkeling, but for the water sports boat rents, paddle boats, kayaks, and sunfish. Beaches, floats, and snorkel sets are available at the concession. Trunk Bay. Ensconced within U.S. Virgin Islands National Park is Trunk Bay in St. John, USVI. The bay's location within the Virgin Islands National Park ensures that the archipelago remains free of aggressive, unsympathetic development, making it one of the most pristine of all places in the Caribbean. The area consists of 3/10 of a mile-long beach that surrounds a half-moon-shaped body of water.
The U.S. drought monitors, which are climatologists, meteorologists, and hydrologists all across the nation who work with researchers at UVI. The scientists from NOAA, National Weather Service, USDA, and many others who use these baseline indicators of droughts. You see, in the USVI, many collect water. To use in their homes for rooftop collection.
What the researchers who review this data see is the stress of vegetation, erosion, and compare these images to others taken over longer periods to determine what the impacts of drought are in the USVI and the region. This helps USDA and the Farm Service Agency aid farmers in the territory when severe drought impacts the island. Right now, we are facing drought conditions, and it appears based on the research here, the territory is headed into an earlier drought season than in years past.
To our fellow future scientists watching today from all across the globe, we hope you enjoy the presentations presented by students across the USVI and the nation as we learn more from NASA scientists about how we as students can join the ranks of NASA and begin our journey to UVI and other universities and study STEM to make this world a better, safer place for all of us.
And now, on to NASA's presentations. Thank you.
Good day. My name is Dr. Stacy Klein Gardner, and I'm an adjunct professor of biomedical engineering at Vanderbilt University in Nashville, Tennessee. I have the pleasure of serving as the co-principal investigator and co-director of the Engineering for Us All project, or E4USA. The E4USA program seeks to demystify and democratize engineering for us all. The overarching goal is to introduce a broad spectrum of students and their teachers to engineering careers through a high school level introductory engineering course. E4USA is so very proud to be represented so strongly today in this wonderful gathering of scientists and engineers. Many thanks to our colleagues at the University of the Virgin Islands for this opportunity. We hope that more high schools around the U.S. will visit our website, e4usa.org, to learn more and consider joining us. Now, off to a wonderful session.
Hi. Let me extend a warm welcome to my fellow scientists and engineers that are joining us today. Greetings from Brentwood High School at Brentwood, Tennessee. We're just south of Nashville. Good to see you all here. We're a proud member of E4USA for the last 3 years, so from its inception. Some of our projects that we work on deal with problems at the school, such as missing locks from the bathroom stalls and how we could possibly lock them for ourselves. Other projects that we work on extend outside of the school through our community partners and partnerships with them, such as with the Nashville Zoo. We're looking forward to spending a little bit of time with you today. Thank you.
Good day, fellow scientists and engineers. Greetings from Brentwood High School, located in Brentwood, Tennessee, just south of Nashville. We are a proud original member of the Engineering for Us All program. Through E4USA, we have learned the importance of the engineering design process, the effectiveness of a strong team dynamic, and the huge impact that creativity has on the entire world.
Right now, we are working on an engineering problem at our own school. Brentwood High School has a separate STEM building from the main high school, so teachers, students, administrators, and SROs have to walk outside on uncovered sidewalks no matter what the weather is. We are interviewing our stakeholders now to make sure we define our problem well. We're planning to address the overall problem using preventative and reactive measures to protect people's belongings.
Before the end of the year, we look forward to solving problems posed by several community partners. We'll create enrichment toys for animals at the Nashville Zoo, design a repair tool for the safety measures around the Nashville Super Speedway track, and solve a problem for the Vanderbilt University Medical Center's Department of Neurosurgery.
Thank you! All Saints Cathedral School in St. Thomas, U.S. Virgin Islands. I'm the head teacher of the E4USA platform at our school. Our students have taken an engineering journey from day one to where they are now. In this video, they're going to show you where we've gone, what we've done, and what they experienced. There's many great things in E4USA, and our students are more than excited to move forward into engineering, even into the college level where they want to go. So thank you for your time. I hope you enjoy our presentation, and for sure, engineering for all.
My name is Ashwin Kim. I'm a student at Austin Cathedral School. I am in 12th grade, and I really enjoy engineering. Now, let me turn it over to my fellow classmates.
Good morning. My name is Hugh Wing. I'm also a student at All Saints Cathedral School, and I'm in the 11th grade. And engineering class is the best thing I ever took.
Hello. My name is Isaiah Francis. I'm also a student at All Saints Cathedral School. I'm in the 12th grade, and I'm glad I took the class.
This is a video that we made to reflect on our engineering journey. Here we are, day number three on our table. Our frame is painted. Good morning, how you doing? All right, we're gonna start by using the drill. Go ahead. Oh my God. Oh my. Good morning, everybody. We are in engineering. Today, we are starting our robot challenge. Everybody's ears are smoking as they start thinking about how this is going to work. Good morning. Here we are, engineering class, doing creating a rain shelter. They're brainstorming the process. We will have an update later. Awesome class. Everybody's hard at work. Oh yeah, this is engineering at its best. So my God, so my God, so my God, so my God.
line up and watch the girl them tweet. What them a bubble and a wine for me tonight. Yeah.
And this is how we they are struggling here. Savannah is struggling. Sophia is struggling how to keep the thing up, but she got hype, but can she do it without holding it? That is the question.
Question. What did you learn from E4USA's robotic arm challenge?
What we learned through the robotic arm challenge is that we needed to complete our objective through set parameters, and through our mistakes and failures, we could better design and make the project more stronger and our prototype stronger.
What are some of the things you learned from your failures throughout the robotic arm?
I learned that there is really nothing called failure. With every fail mistake that you make, it helps you improve and better your design to make the final product, to make it even better, stronger, and more efficient in your project.
How has your initial opinion of engineering changed throughout the year?
My first impression of engineering was that I thought that it was just about wires and hammer and all kind of tools. But when I came to the engineering class, I started learning more about the other type of engineering and how it's everywhere in the world.
In one of my names is Manuel Hodge Baines. I attend All Saints Cathedral School. I'm in the 12th grade. And how can you elaborate and describe the five W's?
First, what we want to look at is the five W's. What, who, where, why, and how. What is the problem at hand? Who is the problem affecting? Where is the problem at? Why would we create or enhance a design to fix the problem? And how? Through our design process.
Is constructing an underwater turbine ethical?
We have to look through our engineering process to see if it's ethical. And how we're going to do that is by studying the marine life and the people around the Virgin Islands to answer that question.
What can we tell you from what we've learned from the robotic arm challenge into real life scenarios?
What we learned from the robotic arm challenge is there's different types of engineering, such as textile, mechanical, and structural engineering, which ties into our next project, the underwater turbine.
Could you elaborate on why did you choose to do an underwater turbine for your next project?
That's a good question, and that leads into our five W's. For the what, is because we need clean energy in the Virgin Islands. For the who is for St. Thomas and St. John. For the where is underwater between St. Thomas and St. John. For the why is because of the constant flow of directional current between St. Thomas and St. John's. And how, that's the question.
What type of engineering do we have to look at when constructing and designing the prototype for the underwater turbine? Could you elaborate?
The different type of engineering we would use is one, textile. We would test and try different types of sealant to see which one is more effective underwater for the underwater turbine. Another type of engineering we would use is mechanical engineering for the mechanical parts that is in the turbine. Another type of engineering we will also use is electrical engineering for all the wires that's in the turbine and also the wires that are connected to the St. Thomas and St. John, which is feeding the energy. And another type of engineering we would also use is structural engineering for the frame and the stand of the underwater turbine to help it lock underwater. And another type of engineering we would use is cooling engineering, which will help us see from outside and above water what's going on to see if the underwater turbines need repair or something went wrong in the turbine.
Hello, I'm NASA astronaut Joe Acaba, coming to you from the Johnson Space Center in Houston, Texas. I want to thank Dr. David Hall and the University of the Virgin Islands faculty, staff, and students for inviting me to share a few words and for working with my NASA colleagues to plan and organize this week-long event. All of this in the midst of a global pandemic. These challenging times have been difficult, so it's important for all of us to remain optimistic and resilient. Despite all, here at NASA, we continue to advance the research and technology to return to the moon. We are still pushing forward with plans to send the first woman and first person of color to the moon under NASA's Artemis program. No human has set foot on the moon since Apollo 17 in 1972, so the possibility of landing on the moon is incredible. As a young kid of descent, I was born and raised in Southern California. I've always enjoyed math and science, but my interest in becoming an astronaut started with my grandfather. He had old films of the Apollo missions, which we enjoyed watching together. I've been fortunate to have so many mentors who supported me and motivated me to be where I am today. Prior to joining NASA, I served as a member of the United States Marine Corps Reserves. I also spent 2 years as a volunteer in the United States Peace Corps. I worked a lot of different jobs until I found the one that I thought and still believe is the most important job on the planet, and that was being a school teacher. For 5 years, I taught math and science to both middle and high school students in Florida. When I became an astronaut, the International Space Station became my classroom. This allowed me to share my love for science, technology, engineering, and mathematics with students around the world. My hope are to inspire the next generation of explorers and leaders and to elevate and highlight the teaching profession and its importance to our society. As you learn more about NASA and all that we do, I want you to remember you are a lot like an astronaut aboard the space station right now. As a result of COVID restrictions, many of you are feeling somewhat isolated and forced to interact virtually with family and friends. But hang in there. Your mission is to remain optimistic and resilient. Before signing off, I want to give a shout out to the USVI teachers, faculty, students, and staff, and all of those nationally and internationally who are joining us from as far away as Hawaii, Tennessee, the Eastern Caribbean, South Africa, India, and Scotland. And finally, to the student presenters from the USVI Cancrine Junior High School, All Saints School, Gift Hill, and Brentwood High School in Tennessee. Thanks for vision and science with us.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Catherine, Catherine Toon. I go by Cat at work, and I'm so excited to be joining you today to talk about some of the things that we do at NASA. So before I start, Zach or Ms. Christina, do y'all have anything that you want to say before we kick it off?
Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for joining on behalf of the University of the Virgin Islands and the College of Science and Math. We're very excited to host NASA. Ms. Kat, take it away.
Awesome. Thank you so much. All right. So getting right into it, my name is Catherine Toon. I graduated in 2013 from the University of Central Florida with a degree in elementary education. So I am also a huge advocate for teachers and know just how important and just how hard that job is. So for all of our teachers that are joining us today, thank you so much, especially having to juggle this during a pandemic and virtual and hybrid. Hats off to y'all. Y'all are doing amazing. So like I said, I taught elementary school prior to working out here. I taught grades 3 through 5 was my main focus, math and science, and I was actually the STEM science club teacher. And then in 2017, I began my job here out at NASA. And then you'll see two pictures. One is with one of my babies, who's not much of a baby anymore. He's now 3. And that's out at Kennedy Space Center in front of one of our launch pads. And then the other picture, one of the cool things about working out at KSC is that you walk outside one day and see some amazing things happening, like the mobile launcher behind me was doing a rollout to the launch pad. And don't worry, we're going to talk all about the mobile launchers and the platforms and everything and ground support equipment that we utilize with Exploration Ground Systems, which is whom I work with, out at NASA at Kennedy Space Center. So just a few more things about me before. When I started out here, I was doing meeting support. So I'm someone who was very good at typing, loved listening into meetings and hearing history being made. And I did that for a couple of years, and now I am a program analyst. So I dig through a lot of documents and read a whole bunch. It's kind of like almost being like a detective trying to search and see what did we say? When did we say that? Is it correct? How can we fix it? And making sure that everything that we're reporting up and out to Congress and with our friends up at DC is correct and all set and good to go. So you see two pictures. One is in front of the Vehicle Assembly Building, which I also have in my background here. And that is a giant building. You see the American flag, that blue portion of the flag, just to give you a little bit of perspective of the size of that building. That blue portion is the size of a regulation NBA basketball court. And each of the stripes, so the red and the white stripes that make up the flag, those are 6 feet across. So those are pretty stinking big, and it doesn't even look like that big of a flag in comparison to the building. So, and we'll talk more about the VAB in just a minute. And then the other picture that you see is me and some of the other wonderful women that I worked with standing inside of the Launch Control Center. And that is the building where our launch director, Charlie Blackwell Thompson, and a lot of our NASA test directors and other support team are tied in on day of launch doing the 3-2-1 clear for takeoff of our launches. And for us, that would be the Artemis missions. And don't worry, we're going to talk about this too. So what we're going to talk about today, like I said, is with Exploration Ground System and all these different parts that we have at Kennedy Space Center in Florida that help us ultimately reach the moon and then one day Mars. So whenever we get the rocket, right, it doesn't come to us preassembled. It doesn't come to us all put together. So if you're someone who likes Legos, and let's face it, I'm not in school anymore and I still love Legos. I play with Legos with my boys all the time. So if you're someone like that likes Legos, we need your help because we get these parts of the rocket and just like a Lego set, it's not put together. And what we do is we have to assemble or put together the rocket and the boosters inside of that giant VAB. So you'll see the bottom two white parts. Those are called the solid rocket boosters. And those are just about the same height as Cinderella's castle, if you've ever been to Walt Disney World over in Florida. And so if you are someone who likes fireworks, those are basically giant 17-story fireworks. Lots of fluids in those and everything else that are gonna help us get our rocket off of planet Earth. And then on top of that, we have the core stage. And again, that's also going to be full of fuel and everything else to help us leave low Earth or get outside of the Earth's atmosphere. And then the guy that's leaning over, again, this isn't the put together rocket, it's the pieces. That is the majority of that is the Orion crew capsule, which is where with our Artemis II, our astronauts will sit on their journey around the moon. And then at the top is one of my favorite pieces. It's called, it looks kind of like a hat. It's called the Launch Abort System. And what that'll do is if everything goes to plan, whenever we break out and we're, you know, getting ready to orbit around the Earth and slingshot over to the moon, that will help pull off and provide a little extra oomph or propulsion or push for our Orion crew capsule. But the cool thing is if there was an issue and we needed to detach our astronauts from the rocket, that launch abort system would help us detach it and pull them over to safety. So like I said, these pieces are, you know, they don't come all together. So it gets to us by boat, by train, by barge, and even by semis and transfer trucks. So to put them all together, like I said, we need a really, 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 really big building. And that's where the VAB, the Vehicle Assembly Building, comes into play. So that building, again, super, super big. We talked about the flag to give you a little bit of idea of how big the building is in comparison to how big that flag is, even though it seems small. So that building is where we assemble or put together and stack the integrated rockets. So those white pieces, the solid rocket boosters, the orange core stage, and then the Array crew capsule and the launch abort system. But when we put it together, we can't just put it on the ground. It would be super heavy, super hard to move. So we have to assemble it onto something. And again, we don't launch inside the vehicle assembly building. That would be a bad day. It would be very messy. So we actually have to take it out to the launch pad. So to get there, it needs a ride. So we have the crawler transporter, and that is what helps give our integrated rocket a ride out to the launch pad. So imagine if you had some cars, some toy cars, and you were to put like a stick or a crayon on top of it, and you were to give it a push. It wouldn't stay, right? It would fall over. We don't want our rocket falling over. So we have the mobile launcher, which is a support platform that helps keep our rocket upright when it's on top of the crawler transporter. It also has different umbilicals that help stabilize and fuel the SLS, the space launch system, our big integrated rocket. And so once we we have to drive real slow all the way to the launch pad, right? You don't want to go super fast with a rocket on top of you. So the crawler transporter goes super, 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 super slow. So when it's fully loaded, it goes about 1 mile an hour. And when it's unloaded, meaning there's not a rocket, not a mobile launcher on there, it goes about 2. So you are faster than a crawler transporter, a rocket carrier. My kids, one who just now figured out how to walk and everything, he's faster. A mouse is faster. However, a turtle is not as fast as the crawler transporter. So again, once we have the crawler transporter and we have the mobile launcher and the launch vehicle, it goes all the way out to the launch pad. So you'll notice that that area is very, 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 very big. And it's right near the water. And so that's, we launch off the coast of Florida. And so whenever we have it all the way out there for safety reasons, and also where my building is near the vehicle assembly building, and even standing all the way out there, which is a mile or two away from the launch pad, you can still, windows rattle, car alarms go off whenever it's going to launch, and you'll be able to feel it in your chest. And that's a couple of miles away. So we clear out our folks. So once it launches from the launch pad, it's going to go somewhere, right? And so we have a couple of different Artemis missions. So the first one is called Artemis 1. And that's where we're going to do kind of like a practice run to end up going to the moon. So with Artemis 2, that one's going to have our astronauts inside the Orion crew capsule, which we talked a little bit about, and we'll talk a little bit more about her shortly. And then we'll have, and they'll slingshot around the moon and go to the furthest point past the moon that humans have been. And then they'll end up going home, and then that'll set the page for Artemis 3 and 4 when we ultimately land back at the moon. And like the video said, we'll have the first female and the first person of color stepping foot on the moon. So if we can go to the next one, perfect. So again, we have the crawler transporter, the mobile launcher, the rocket, everything's good to go. Charlie Blackwell Thompson has given the final countdown. Our NASA test directors have worked with our other centers and are communicating and everything else. Everything's good to go, and we finally lift off. Well, like I said, where are we going? We're going to the moon. It takes us about 3 days to get to the moon. And I know a lot of people will ask, why? Why are we going to the moon? We already did that. Well, the cool thing is that the moon is going to provide a proving ground or a place for us to practice working and living in deep space. We're going to explore more of the moon than we have before, ultimately learn how to convert the ice that they found at the moon and turn that into fuel. I can't tell you how they do that. That's not my job. That's a whole nother math section. But they're going to practice living and working in space for when we ultimately go to Mars, because the moon, like I said, is 3 days away, whereas Mars is 9 months away. So it'll take 9 months to get to Mars, 9 months to get back, whereas with the moon, it'll take 3 days to get there and 3 days to get back. So once we land on the moon, we've done what we needed to do on the moon. We need to go back home, right? Back to Earth. And so what our astronauts will do is they'll be riding in the Orion crew capsule, and that will have to splash back down onto Earth into the ocean. So when we do that, like you'll see in the picture in the top right, we have the Orion crew capsule. It's kind of like a little cone with its googly eyes. And then it has the parachutes on top, and several sets of parachutes will deploy to help slow down the Orion crew capsule and let it splash safely into the ocean. If you're someone who loves the Navy and you want to work with the Navy and still work with NASA, boy, do I have a job for you. So cool. We have our recovery team, and what they'll do is we work with the Navy and we partner with them. And whenever the capsule splashes down, we have a team that sets out to go to recover the capsule. So they have to check first, is it safe to get near, the fuels that are coming out, if there's any. We have divers go and take pictures of everything and make sure that we're all good to go. And then we'll work together to retrieve the crew with Artemis II and retrieve the capsule and bring it all back and get ready to do it all over again. So we have a lot of ground support, a lot of working pieces that ultimately will help us leave Earth, get to Moon, and then to Mars. And with that, I think I'm passing it over to Dr. Garcia.
Hello, good morning. Can you hear me and see me?
We can hear you. It looks like your video. There we are. Perfect. We can see it. Thank you, Dr. Garcia.
Thank you, Kat, for that wonderful presentation. I hope that a lot of the students here are joining us this morning for the first time. They'll be listening and learning about Artemis and all the wonderful things that NASA is doing. So it's great to talk to you this morning. So I do have a presentation I would like to share. And tell you a little bit more about the crew.
Dr. Garcia, one moment. It sounds like there's something over your mic. Is there maybe a piece of paper over the laptop there?
What is that? Is that better?
Do you have a headset?
Just 1 second.
That was actually a little bit better. Giving you a weird echo. Yes.
Is that better?
Yes.
Okay. Awesome. Okay, so I'm going to start sharing the presentation. See if we can do this.
And Dr. Garcia, if you go to the slideshow tab there. You should be able to see the monitor tab there. You should be able to change it's all the way. There you go. You should be able to change which monitor you want it to display on. So that should solve your problem.
Okay, so let's give this a shot. Is that better?
Perfect.
Okay. Well, good morning, everyone. And thank you very much for joining us. My name is Samuel Garcia. I'm an education specialist at Kennedy Space Center. And it's truly an honor to be here with you this morning. I Like I mentioned, she is a former educator. I'm a former high school teacher. I taught high school level for 7 years. I'm a native of Texas. I was born along the Texas and Mexico border. And it was the best time. I totally understand the value of education and believe in it so much that I went on to earn several degrees and made it a career focus to make sure that students have knowledge, access, opportunities, and just an awareness of what's out there in the world. And so that those decisions and those experiences eventually led me to where I'm at today. And so now I'm an education specialist, and that means that I look student, the students are going to be really cool. Teenagers, normally, pre-pandemic, go out to the islands and talk to you and be in touch with you in person and do activities or hands-on type of challenges and that sort of thing. And so this is me a few years ago, before we had to start wearing masks. And we started to start, of course, isolation and measures and procedures. So I did that, and that's been our challenge, just to make sure and inspire generations, the next generations of professionals that are going to put the technologies, the tools, the instruments that are going to help us learn more about, you know, our planet and our universe. So this is just me, some of the opportunities that I've had in 7 years ago to support. And so it's been a wonderful experience. I worked with students from all ages, teachers from all different corners of the country. And this is just some of highlights. Regarding me and my career as an education specialist. But to consider, you know, NASA has, you know, over 60 years of work, of amazing work, and NASA for us has a different, you know, has many different meanings, but NASA stands for National Aeronautics and Space Administration. And NASA really focuses on many areas. People don't even know that NASA is very diverse. There's so many different things that NASA is responsible for, and also it's always going to highlight that more about space exploration, and that's a really important piece. The work that NASA does, but NASA focuses on aviation, right? Aeronautics, and seeing this experimental aircraft that NASA is currently developing the technology around. So NASA heavily focuses on research and how to best improve our current aircraft, but also bringing away from new, faster, and more efficient aircraft as well. Flight, certain robotics is going to be key also in the missions and everything. And of course, Earth science is so valuable. In today's world, we know that about climate, and I know, you know, students and teachers from the Virgin Islands, focus a lot on Earth science and climate change. And so NASA heavily invests in this area. Especially now, the state administration for climate change has been, you know, one of the top priorities, and some of the decisions they've made reflect that. And so there's been more and more investment in understanding how our Earth works, and science missions that help us really understand what's going on and how we can help improve our climate and protect future generations. NASA has 10 different centers. Main centers, we are located at Kennedy Space Center in Florida, is in the U.S. And so at each red dot, you see that we're designated NASA center. But then you see other blue purple dots as well. And those are NASA facilities, those are research centers. So think about, when you think about and see all these different things, realizing that there's so many different places you can work for and still part of the NASA community and NASA family. So, you know, we have technicians, we have engineers, researchers, educators, doctors, lawyers, you name it. And we need individuals that need to be centers to help them build the operations moving forward. But that means that there are so many different opportunities for you as well. So, if you want to explore this, you know, put in space on it, you want to go to California, or you're interested in a certain mission or thing, then, you know, each of these centers focus on different tasks and missions. And so I encourage you to, you know, learn more about the center, see what you know, you like, and what missions they're going to be. So I mean, you can learn more and see that how you can help make good decisions and fun decisions as to what you want to do and what types of careers you want to pursue. I mentioned that Artemis is our next chapter in group space exploration. We are returning to the moon, but it's time to stay. And this time, we're going to take the first woman and the first person of color. So Artemis is truly going to be historical moment, just like we remember after. I'm just going to ask a question to you, remember, who is the first person to walk a step foot on the moon? And when you say Neil Armstrong, you're correct, right? Neil Armstrong touched the surface of the moon back in 1969, and his name will be remembered forever, right? And so now we're in the next chapter, we are, you know, when you think about it, we are some of the first women that women will be in history forever. And so we have person of color. So those two individuals will truly be historical figures for generations to come. And that's part of this enormous involvement to the moon. And so, of course, we need astronauts, right, that comprise the team. And so NASA has to make 18 astronauts, and you see these wonderful individuals, right, highly dedicated, super intelligent, smart, you know, highly motivated individuals. And one of the things that I was like to encourage teachers and students and parents is to really to take time to get to know who these people are. You can research their background, some of the things they've been able to accomplish, some of the challenges that they had to overcome. Some of these stories are amazing, and we can relate to these individuals, right? And so this is us. This is 2022. This is what NASA this is the community that we now have part of this team. Very different from, you know, the in 1960, where we were all men in the military. But now we have such a diverse crew, and it's just phenomenal. And so the opportunities for you to be participating in something like this have just opened up, right? I mean, you can think about it. You know, it's just been a tremendous, tremendous change here. In your future, hey, you never know, this could be you as well. So let's talk quickly about some of the jobs or careers that exist at NASA. I want to talk to you about Sleepy. Sleepy have been kind of NASA, a great supporter of NASA and partner because in the 1970s, 60s and 70s during the Apollo missions, Sleepy was also part of this mission to the moon. And so now Snoopy with Artemis, Snoopy has this wonderful connection and this legacy. And so Artemis and Snoopy will be making their way to the moon as well in the upcoming Artemis launches. So astronauts, like I mentioned, they are a small, dedicated group of individuals that work really hard. They use their lives, they train hundreds and hundreds of hours, and they sacrifice so much for being away from their family. They put their bodies through a lot of stress, and so they are amazing, so brave individuals, right? And so we see here an astronaut conducting a spacewalk. The International Space Station. But besides that, there's so many careers at NASA, beginning with us, you see on the left-hand corner, between interns. Internships, students can be a part of NASA at the age of 16. So if you are in elementary school, maybe in third, fourth, fifth grade, you're not that far from turning 16. Right? So you can start thinking about, maybe when I turn 16, I'm going to apply to work on projects at NASA, with engineers, right? So I encourage you to do that, to start thinking about that. We have technicians and people that work on airplanes, that work on robotics and the instructions that we need. Food scientists that help us food grow food in space and understand what methods to work best. And that plans to help space to help just the health and wellness of our astronauts. We have people that facilitate, of course, flight and controllers that manage these different programs. And then we have launch pad people that work on construction, building these launch pads. Well, a launch pad we can launch a rocket. So we have these individuals building these pads, we're going to be able to do this important work. Social media, right? It's hot. People love social media, and now we're in the age where every institution and even schools have social media accounts. And so we need individuals to help manage, to help share this technology and this funding for work with the public. Geologists, graphic designers, being the artists, that's such a key job right now. And so we have individuals that just focus on creating videos and graphics and posters and different types of artwork to help tell the story of NASA. Individuals that design spacesuits, right? Robotics designers, astronaut trainers, people that help astronauts do successfully underwater. We have all these different types of careers. NASA. The best part is that, it's open to anybody and it's not strictly limited to STEM, right? And so you can be a non-STEM from the non-STEM field and still work with NASA. Computer programmers, planners, community experts, such as this one now as well. Writers, I like to highlight the importance of writers and bloggers and individuals that help quantify the work that NASA doing, such as these two individuals that help tell the story and NASA that we, study them and do the work. I want to just highlight the arts. I think it's really important to do that. And here, I'm not sure if you can tell, but this is an administration in the 1970s. This is the 1970s, that space colonies, and and so this is just an example of one artist's rendition of what it could possibly look like. This is a study, some work that has been in the 70s, and it's like a donut shaped, and you see that, you see some houses, you see communities there, and that's what we're imagining that living in space work, right? And so we need artists to help us see things in this visual manner. And like I mentioned before, artists are responsible for drawing when you can't see, right? We just haven't traveled through these places, and spacecraft have looked at the data, and then our engineer scientists make sense of that, and then we work with artists to help picture what these places look like, right? And so we have these posters that are in design. And then we also have mission patches. Anytime there's a mission to space, there's always a patch, right? And so we have all this to help conceptualize and to help draw when we create graphics, right? And we become legendary. And at the bottom, you see this wonderful mural that was painted a number of years back, and it's at the Miami Research Center. And But just to show you the hand in hand that engineering and science and math go hand in hand with yes. It's a beautiful combination, it's a beautiful blend. So if you're interested in both, you can blend both your skills, right? You're interested in space, you want to do something, but you also have this amazing artistic talent. This is one way you can contribute and utilize your talent. And some of the photographers out there, photographers, platforms, momentous achievements, right? This man who's in a flying plane, looking at some studies. Like I mentioned, last effect, this is also on aircraft and airplanes. So they're out there snapping and taking pictures of these planes out there in the sky. So our photographers, not only in the studio, but they're out there and they're taking photos as well. Teachers, like I mentioned, teachers are also valuable, and there are a handful of teachers, there are a number of us out here that have this teaching background that are contributing to this work, and so we need others to be the same and show the and give a message out about all the wonderful resources there and that's what has to offer. And of course, I'm talking about my students. Students are essential, you're critical, you're special, and you are highly valued. And so we need our students to partner up, to contribute, to participate in these activities, to demonstrate that we are contributing, we are doing and making a difference. And so you are the future, you are future, and you are nurturing that, and should be able to come. All of us family, that's a family. And so I told you to start looking at ways that you can just increase your talent and your skill sets so that when you're still able to start applying for these amazing learning opportunities. Before I finish, I just want to show that you can start practicing your skill sets right now. For example, if you're not an artist, we have these amazing opportunities for you to start developing your skill sets or enhancing your skill sets. And one way to participate in these videos and this activity called trial artemis. So you watch a certain videos. About spacecraft that I mentioned about, and all the different components of Artemis, the long have a chance to actually draw it. And there's tutorials, and you can share your artwork with us by using that hashtag down there. So, my friends, are you ready to join our club? We can be with you. We need you to become part of this thing, and we can want to see all the amazing things we're going to do in the future. So, thanks for your attention, and I'd be happy to take any questions if there's time. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Garcia. I think maybe I know you're having a little bit of trouble with your mic, so I'm not sure what the issue might be, but go ahead and talk right now for me, Dr. Garcia. Yeah, it's for whatever reason your sound is 180 degrees different than it was in our last session. So
I'm not sure whether having the reasons. So
sometimes when that happens, I have to like exit and come back in.
That's a good idea, Christina.
Yeah, maybe try that and we'll wait for you for questions. I have a few. It's a little confusing. I'm getting them on my cell phone chat as text messages. So if we can go through them, but we'll wait for you, Dr. Garcia. Go out and come back, please. Maybe that will help.
Yeah, there he goes. He should be back in a second here.
Yes, it was really staticky there.
Yeah, I don't know, because obviously in our last session, his mic was perfectly fine. So.
Yeah, very weird. Could be just maybe the wind or something too. We have that here. Wind, rain, doesn't matter. A little sleet and snow might affect it as well. But
we had a little bit of a freeze today.
Oh, really?
In Florida, the Kennedy Space Center.
Oh, no, I love oranges. That's not a good sign. Let's see if he comes back in.
Well, if he doesn't, here he is.
Yeah, there. Okay.
If he's continuing to have problems, we can move forward, and Kat and I can do our best to answer the questions. And when he joins, he can just join right in when the questions when he gets back. So here, I'll go ahead and turn on my camera so everyone can see my face.
There you go. Yay, good afternoon. Okay, so my first question is, it's from a teacher, a homeschool teacher slash mom, who would like to know, what are the jobs that are available for students who don't want to do the traditional pathway into STEM, i.e., I think she's talking about vocational or business school?
Perfect. So I'm so glad that someone asked that question. So, you know, as a kid, for me personally, although I loved science, math and science were not my strong suit. And honestly, that's okay. You could still work at NASA and maybe not be an engineer. As Dr. Garcia was showing, we have all these different positions. And, you know, we have a launch pad mechanic. We have our engine controllers and engineers. We have NASA test directors. We have all sorts of different folks. So if college is not a path that you are wanting to take, it doesn't psych you up. Although we would love to have as many engineers as possible. Spoiler alert, I'm not an engineer and I still work here too. We have a lot of trade and technical skills that are in heavy demand out here with NASA. You know, you can have folks that are great at coding and great at engineering and everything else, but we still need people to help us build the pad and make sure all of our launch infrastructure and our ground support equipment is truly working the way it should and that everything is welded correctly. We have a huge need for welders. So there are tons of other technical and trade schools and skill sets that we absolutely need are in extremely high demand that don't necessarily require a college degree. So thank you for asking that question.
Perfect. Yeah, absolutely. And to just kind of jump on Kat's comment, I think the arts is a great opportunity to get into a career like this without having to have a traditional college degree. I mean, you can learn so many things on your own through YouTube, learning how to do art through Photoshop or digital products. There are just so many opportunities now to learn through the internet and really build those skills and a good portfolio to show interviewers. And that doesn't always require a degree. So there are many different options.
Perfect. Okay, we have a question from one of the homeschool groups. I have to go back to it. It is, hang on. Okay, if you land on Mars, what would you do if you found a new element? And that is from St. Thomas St. John Homeschool Group, teacher Ms. Hayes.
Kat, I can take this one if you like.
Perfect. My thing is I would name it after me. That's what I would do.
And that's probably exactly what would happen if somebody did find a new element, which is probably unlikely at this point. We have done a lot of testing on the surface of Mars, and we have a lot of samples and data to go through about it. So it's not likely that we would find something completely surprising once we get there. But if we did, the process is generally the person who discovered that would choose a name for it. And, you know, scientists would have to go through the process of studying what that new discovery means for the community, for NASA, and for the rest of the scientific world. It would certainly be a huge discovery to find a new element. Well, it would change a lot of the things that we understand about the world. So that would be exciting for sure.
Okay, so we have a question from one, she says they're third grade, but she doesn't tell me which school, but that's okay. I'm getting phone numbers, so I apologize if I don't call you out. For the little third grader who wanted to know, in the rocket, when the bottom drops off, does that make sense? Okay. Is it trash? Is it space trash, I guess? And do you recycle the trash? That's a really good question from a third grader. Love that.
So that is a really good question. Part of it is recovered. And I know in the past that we've utilized portions to help build coral reefs. Some of it burns up slightly in their atmosphere. But some of the parts, unfortunately, we are not able to recycle and recover in that method to be able to use them again. But that's why we need great minds like you to help us figure out how we can be fully sustainable and be as, I mean, we are at Kennedy Space Center, we are very mindful of our carbon footprint and how we're impacting our environment. We are on a giant nature preserve and, you know, monitoring all of that. So anything that we can do in future advances towards being even more economic or environmentally conscious is huge. So thank you. That's why we need you, third grader. Come on.
Okay. And I have her sister. It says, my sister has a question. Do you get to see the stars and do they really blow up? Interesting.
Okay, I guess I can take this one. I will assume that this question is referring to astronauts when they're in space. Can they see stars? And I believe that they can. I don't think that they look too much different than the way we view them from Earth, other than obviously there's no light pollution in space. And yes, stars do explode. they hopefully explode very far away from us. And it takes us, obviously, the speed of light is the fastest light can travel. And so we learn about those events in the universe much, much later than when they actually happen. So astronomers have observed stars exploding, but again, they aren't able to see that in real time. It takes years and sometimes hundreds of years and sometimes longer than that to be able to observe those things with the light that we receive from those events.
Okay, in that same little group, this must be a St. Thomas homeschool group. They have a little first grader, and her name is Lisa, and she would like to know if a space rock is space junk. Is that an asteroid?
That's a great question. I don't know how NASA categorizes space junk. I assume that it partially has to do with junk would be referred to something that we created that is orbiting the planet or floating in space. I don't think I don't believe that we would consider asteroids or organic material as that's apart from human caused as junk. Mostly it's things that we produced, we created, and for whatever reason, they're floating in space.
Okay, and we have a question from a third grader. Oh, this is a good question. They're doing plants in school right now, and they would like to know if you do plant science or will you do plant ID, plant identification in space?
So that is a really good question. And we'll put a link into the chat on the growing plants in space. So we do grow vegetables and different vegetation in space at the International Space Station right now. They actually grew and harvested peppers not all that long ago, and we're able to like eat those and everything else. So it is really important that we do study our plants and how to best grow them, and what type of, you know, UV light or whatever to utilize to help them best grow in the environment of space, you know, with reduced gravity and everything else. So that is huge that we do study that. And at, you know, in space, we do a whole lot of studying of materials, you know, not just plants, but the impacts on the human body. All different inventions have been done through our need and desire to get, live, and be sustainable while in space. So yes, ma'am, they do grow plants. They study them, we record them, send stuff back to Earth for them to check it out too. So there is a lot of studying of plants that go on.
That is great. Okay, so, okay. Okay, so one last question for both of you before we go. We have 4 minutes left. Oh my goodness, what's happening? Hang on.
And it does look like Dr. Garcia is with us.
Okay.
So it looks like he should be able to answer a last heavy-hitting question.
So Dr. Garcia, before we close out, can you talk briefly about the posters, how they're designed, who comes up with the theme, and how that relates to the mission?
Yeah, of course. Can you hear me now? Is it better?
Oh my goodness, wonderful, we can hear you. Yay, team.
Finally, that worked like a charm, Christina, thank you. So that's a great question. Like I mentioned, NASA's art, space art program was started in 1962. It was the administrator, he wanted to make sure that the agency really captured all the great things it was doing. It was a way to excite the public, you know, and what NASA was doing. And so since then, we've had different professionals. Some are full-time graphic designers. Sometimes they're interns. We have interns that design our posters, our outreach materials, flyers, you name it. It just depends on the need, right? So right now, I know, for example, EGS, they had several interns in the past that helped design, you know, materials for them. And so it just depends on the different missions, who is leading that project. And sometimes, you know, it just depends if there's a student that shows and demonstrates this talent, they might ask you like, hey, can you work on this? And they'll have you start working on it. Or if you happen to be an intern and you share like, I'm also an artist, I want to contribute, then, you know, opportunities for you and opportunities can open up for you that way as well. So we have professionals dedicated to just this. And then we have, you know, interns, young people that help also lend their talents to this amazing work. So it just depends on what the need is and who's available and really what the mission is currently, the mission that's currently being facilitated.
We have 1 minute left. Ms. Kat, I want to ask you a closing question. So you said that you weren't very good at math and science when you were younger. It wasn't your topic of choice. How did you get through that part of college to end up at NASA?
That's a really good question. So for me, I'm a very type A person. So if I was not the best at I didn't want to do it. So it took a lot of looking in the mirror and realizing, hey, it's okay not to be the smartest person in the room. You know, if you are the smartest person in the room, you need to find a new room. So that way you're going to challenge yourself. But a lot of it was reaching out for help. I mean, I went to every tutoring session available, whether it was at school or outside of school at the library, to really build my confidence, because that's what it was. My dislike for math at that time came from not feeling confident in myself and what I knew with math and with science. So just reaching out to teachers, to friends who were doing better in those classes and those subjects than I was. I wish they would have had YouTube when I was in elementary school, because there's a lot of great resources that are available now with YouTube and all these different apps to really help students and parents too, because I know that things change a lot with learning that. So that was my big thing, was just continue to push through and ask for help. And even still now, working with NASA, I ask for help a lot. So if you're not asking for help, then you're probably doing something wrong.
Super. Well, thank you all for your support and assistance in sharing your journey at NASA with all of the students from the Virgin Islands and across the globe. We will be back at 1 o'clock with our last virtual assembly of the day. Stay tuned, and we'll be back at 1 o'clock.
Bye.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye, everyone. Thank you all.
Zach, should we close out, or should we leave it up?